going to be talking about countries that no longer exist in Europe. So the idea of this video is we're going to take a look at some countries that used to be countries throughout the course of European history, and we're just going to take a look at them in Wikipedia and have a little talk about them. Some of these I know a little bit about, and some of them I don't really know much about at all. So this is going to be a learning experience for me as much as it is for you, hopefully. If you enjoy this video, please drop a comment, let me know what you think. Anything you know about these former countries, it'd be nice to have a conversation in the comments below. If you enjoy, please drop a like and maybe consider subscribing as well. And you can also become a channel member down below with exclusive perks. So, as I say, we're just going to go through the Wikipedia pages. The first one, as you can see here, is East Germany. I know a little bit about East Germany. Obviously, before I was born, I was born in 1999, so East Germany was never a thing when I've been alive. From what I understand, when Germany was partitioned into four to the Allies after the end of the Second World War, the section that was given to the Soviet Union was East Germany, and eventually, as tensions arose in Europe between the Western world and communist states in the East, it became its own country, and it was kind of the westernmost point of the Soviet Union. So we're just going to read a couple of paragraphs here, and then I'm going to move on to some of these sections down here. So East Germany, or Ostdeutschland, officially the German Democratic Republic, Deutsche Demokratische Republik, was a country in Central Europe that existed from its creation on the 7th of October 1949 until its dissolution on the 3rd of October 1990. Until 1989, it was generally viewed as a communist state, and it described itself as a socialist workers and peasants state. Before its establishment, the country's territory was administered and occupied by Soviet forces with the autonomy of native communists, following the Berlin Declaration abolishing German sovereignty in World War II. When the Potsdam Agreement established the Soviet-occupied zone bounded on the east by the Oder-Neisse Line, so that's what I was just talking about, the Potsdam Agreement, after World War II, the leaders of the Allies met to decide what would become of Germany, and it was split into four, I think. There was a US controlled zone, a British controlled zone, a French controlled zone, and this area here, which was controlled by the Soviet Union. As you can see here on this map, this green section here, so this, can we zoom in? Yes. So this green section is East Germany. This bit here where my mouse is tracing is the whole of Germany as it stands today. And this is what was East Germany, or the German Democratic Republic. Where were we? The GDR was dominated by the Socialist Unity Party of Germany, SED, a communist party from 1949 to 1989, before being democratized and liberalized under the impact of the revolutions of 1989 against the communist states, helping East Germany be united with the West. Unlike West Germany, SED did not see its state as the successor of the German Reich and abolished the goal of unification in the Constitution 1974. Under the SED rule, GDR was often judged as a Soviet satellite state. Most scholars and academics described it as a totalitarian regime. The GDR was established in the Soviet-occupied zone of former Nazi Germany by the SED on the 7th of October 1949, while the Federal Republic of Germany, preceded by the fragmentary self-governance of West German politics, commonly referred to as West Germany, was established as a liberal democracy in the three Western US, UK, French occupied zones before, as I just said then. It was a satellite state of the Soviet Union. Soviet occupation authorities began transferring administrative responsibility to German communist leaders in 1948, and the GDR began to function as an independent state on the 7th of October 1949, gaining nearly full sovereignty from the Soviet Union in 1955, although the Soviet Union maintained troops in and substantial political influence over the country. In 1972, East Germany was recognized by West Germany and vice versa, as well as the two German independent countries together, as well as these two German independent countries together, became two separate members of the United Nations the following year. Until 1989, the GDR was governed by the Socialist Unity Party of Germany, Communist Party, founded in the Soviet occupied zone in 1946, although other parties nominally participated in its alliance organization, the National Front of the German Democratic Republic. SED made the teaching of Marxism, Leninism, and the Russian language compulsory in schools in the GDR. Let's move on. I want to talk about history. Origins at the Yalta Conference during World War II, the Allies, i.e. the United States, the United Kingdom, and the USSR, agreed on dividing a defeated Germany into occupation zones and on dividing Berlin, the German capital, among the Allied powers as well. Initially, this meant the formation of three zones of occupation, i.e. American, British, and Soviet. Later, a French zone was carved out of the US and British zones. So, one thing that's really interesting that generally comes up when we talk about East Germany is that the capital of Berlin, which, as we just talked about, was split between the Allies, actually was within, so I'm going to zoom back into this map here. If you can see this little dot in the middle of the green bit, that's Berlin. So technically, Berlin was also split and was within East Germany. So it's a very strange thing. It almost became an enclave. And there was things like the Berlin Airlift, which happened in 19... I can't remember what year. Let's see if we can find the Berlin Airlift. Yeah, so if you can see here, this west side of Berlin itself was in the control of the Allies, but the east side of Berlin was controlled by the Soviets. Deepening conflict between the Western powers and the Soviet Union over the unresolved status of West Berlin led to the Berlin blockade in 1948 to 1949. The Soviet army initiated the blockade by halting Allied rail, road, and water traffic to and from West Berlin. The Allies countered the Soviets with the Berlin airlift of food, fuel, and supplies to West Berlin. So the crux of that basically is that because Berlin was in this Soviet-owned territory, the Soviets blocked all paths that would allow the Allies to send supplies to West Berlin in an attempt to basically put Berlin under the control of the Soviets fully. But instead of using all of these land, sort of ground methods, the Allies just opted to fly in supplies, and they flew them in at such a ridiculous rate. You know, there was like planes landing and taking off like every, I don't know, I think it was minutes apart. So that was incredible. And there's a really cool picture actually. If you look, there's a satellite image of Berlin, and it shows, because I guess the lights that were used as standard in the Western Occupied Zone and the Eastern Occupied Zone were different. The eastern side was more like sort of like a yellowy colour, and the western side was like a more brighter, sort of like an LED style light. There's actually, you can still see the border of West and East Berlin from above because the lights are different colours. Go and look it up if you haven't seen it already, it's really cool. So there's still evidence of the split. I've been to Berlin actually, and it is quite noticeable. I think the western side of the city is generally more developed. But yeah, I actually stayed in a hostel opposite Berlin Ostbahnhof, which is the east train station. So I was in what used to be East Berlin, and the Berlin Wall was actually right next to a small remaining part of the Berlin Wall was right next to my hostel. So yeah, really cool. It was very indicative of the tension at the time, as we've mentioned. And I don't think it ever really got resolved properly until the Berlin Wall came down. I think there was generally a feeling or an attitude of people in East Berlin wanting to get into West Berlin, but there was obviously a massive wall up and it was guard stationed there with guns and things like that. And there were times when I think tanks were, I can't remember exactly when this was, maybe during Kennedy's presidency, or maybe around that time, where tanks were stationed either side of the wall, and basically all out war could have broken out at any point, and somehow a deal was struck or something like that, and the tanks slowly backed away on both sides. And that's to do with all the things like mutually assured destruction, you know, and it's still talked about today. You know, war would basically just mean destruction of the earth because of nuclear weapons, etc. So yeah, it generally started, and those tensions were probably most, I guess, Berlin was like a microcosm for the tensions worldwide. So yeah. Okay, that's East Germany. It's a very brief look, but we got to talk about a little bit of history. Okay, so we're going to move on to Yugoslavia. Now, we've already drawn a map of Yugoslavia, so if that might interest you, go and check it out, it's on the channel. My extent of knowledge about Yugoslavia is not great. I just know that it was basically most of the Balkan states were a part of Yugoslavia, like Serbia and Croatia, Bosnia, Montenegro, all those places, Macedonia, etc. And I think the main reason that it split was because there were so many different ethnic groups, and who all sort of had their own identity. But yeah, let's read, shall we? So Yugoslavia, I'm not going to try and pronounce it in any of those languages, land of the South Slavs, was a country in Southeast and Central Europe that existed from 1918 to 1992. It came into existence in 1918 following World War I under the name of the Kingdom of Serbs, Croats and Slovenes from the merger of the Kingdom of Serbia with the Provisional State of Slovenes, Croats and Serbs, which was formed from the territory of the former Austria-Hungary and constituted the first union of South Slavic peoples as a sovereign state, following centuries of foreign rule over the region under the Ottoman Empire and Austria-Hungary. Peter I of Serbia was its first sovereign. The kingdom gained international recognition on July 13, 1922, at the Conference of Ambassadors in Paris. The official name of the state was changed to Kingdom of Yugoslavia in 1929. The kingdom was invaded by the Axis powers on the 6th of April 1941. In 1943, a democratic federal Yugoslavia was proclaimed by the partisan resistance. In 1944, King Peter II, then living in exile, recognised it as the legitimate government. The monarchy was subsequently abolished in November 1945. Yugoslavia was renamed the Federal People's Republic of Yugoslavia. In 1945, when a communist government was established, it acquired the territories of Istria, Rijeka and Zadar from Italy. Partisan leader Josip Broz Tito ruled the country from 1944 as its prime minister and later as president until his death in 1980. In 1963, the country was renamed for the final time as the Socialist Federal Republic of Yugoslavia. The six constituent republics that made up the SFRY were the Socialist Republics of Bosnia and Herzegovina, Croatia, Macedonia, Montenegro, Serbia, and Slovenia. Socialist Republic of Serbia contained the two Socialist Autonomous Provinces, Vojvodina and Kosovo. So Kosovo is now its own country. I mean, it's debated hotly. I don't know too much about it, so I won't say much. But yeah, I think Kosovo is recognised by quite a lot of UN nations now as its own country, which after 1974 were largely equal to the other members of the Federation. After an economic and political crisis in the 1980s and the rise of nationalism and ethnic tensions, so that's what I was talking about, like all of the different, what used to be their own countries, I guess, or their own kingdoms, had, you know, there was a big, it was like a melting pot of different ethnic groups, etc., and tensions were growing and nationalism. Yugoslavia broke up along its republic's borders, at first into five countries leading to the Yugoslav Wars from 1993 to 2017. Oh, sorry, leading to the Yugoslav Wars, full stop. From 1993 to 2017, the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia tried political and military leaders from the former Yugoslavia for war crimes, genocide and other crimes committed during those wars. After the breakup, the Republics of Montenegro and Serbia formed a reduced federative state, the Federal Republic of Yugoslavia, known from 2003 to 2006 as Serbia and Montenegro. This state aspired to be the status of sole legal successor to the SFRY, but those claims were opposed by the other former republics. Eventually, it accepted the opinion of the Badinter Arbitration Committee about shared succession, and in 2003 its official name was changed to Serbia and Montenegro. This state dissolved, and Montenegro and Serbia each became independent states in 2006, with Kosovo having an ongoing dispute over its declaration of independence in 2008. So yeah, that's what I just said. Still ongoing, and I don't think there'll be a you know, an amicable solution very soon. But I just, I never even realised that there was a dispute ongoing, just because I'd seen Kosovo playing as its own team in like football tournaments and things like that. I just always thought it was. But yeah, obviously that's ongoing, so I won't talk too much about it because I don't really know anything about it. Yeah, it's interesting. I'd always thought of Yugoslavia as older than it was, but I mean, Yugoslavia was still around in some capacity even when I was born. So yeah, interesting. What else do I want to look at? Let's talk about World War II, shall we? Because I know for a fact that Yugoslavia was one of the only smaller countries to basically resist Nazi occupation. At 5:12 a.m. on the 6th of April 1941, German, Italian and Hungarian forces invaded Yugoslavia. The German Air Force, the Luftwaffe, bombed Belgrade, which is now in Serbia, and other major Yugoslav cities. On the 17th of April, representatives of Yugoslavia's various nations, various regions, signed an armistice with Germany in Belgrade, ending 11 days of resistance against the invading German forces. More than 300,000 Yugoslav officers and soldiers were taken prisoner. The Axis powers occupied Yugoslavia and split it up. The independent state of Croatia was established as a Nazi satellite state ruled by the fascist militia known as the Ustase, something like that, that came into existence in 1929, but it was relatively limited in its activities until 1941. German troops occupied Bosnia and Herzegovina, as well as part of Serbia and Slovenia, while other parts of the country were occupied by Bulgaria, Hungary and Italy. From 1941 to 1945, the Croatian Ustase regime persecuted and murdered around 300,000 Serbs, along with at least 30,000 Jews and Roma. Hundreds of thousands of Serbs were also expelled, and another 200,000 to 300,000 were forced to convert to Catholicism. So, yeah, this just, I think, backs up that even as a united nation, there was a lot of tension between the republics within the country. And obviously, one would assume that that bad blood probably stemmed, at least in some part, from this, as well as historic, you know, even before the 1900s, I'm sure there was many conflicts and things like that. So yeah, Yugoslavia is a really interesting one. What's this? FBR Yugoslavia. November 11th, 1945, elections were held, with the only communist-led People's Front appearing on the ballot, securing all 354 seats. Shock there. On the 29th of November, while still in exile, King Peter II was deposed by Yugoslavia's Constituent Assembly, and the Federal People's Republic of Yugoslavia was declared. However, he refused to abdicate. Marshal Tito was now in full control, and all opposition elements were eliminated. On the 31st of January 1946, the new constitution of the Federal People's Republic of Yugoslavia, modelled after the constitution of the Soviet Union, established six republics, an autonomous province, and an autonomous district that were part of Serbia. The federal capital was Belgrade. The policy focused on a strong central government under the control of the Communist Party, and on recognition of the multiple nationalities. The flags and republics used versions of the red flag of or Slavic tricolour with a red star in the centre or in the canton. So yeah, we have the Socialist Republic of Bosnia and Herzegovina, Sarajevo, which is still the capital of Bosnia and Herzegovina today. Socialist Republic of Croatia, Zagreb. Socialist Republic of Macedonia with Skopje. Socialist Republic of Montenegro with Titograd. So that was common to basically put Podgorica is the name of it. Oh, Podgorica is the name today, but it used to be called Titograd. Just in the same way there used to be Stalingrad. Grad and Leningrad. It was common for the leader's name to be put in front of Grad, I think. Socialist Republic of Serbia, Belgrade, and then SAB Kosovo, Pristina, which is now seen as the capital of Kosovo. And SAB Vojvodina with Novi Sad. And then the Socialist Republic of Slovenia with Ljubljana, which is still its capital today. So yeah, different coats of arms, generally a similar flag. And I think this is what's generally seen as the Yugoslavian flag. Or at least what I've seen on most sort of things I've read about it, but yeah. So that's a little bit about Yugoslavia. Again, it's some of the things are quite sensitive in terms of like the conflicts, and I don't really know enough about it to weigh in. So I've tried to be as careful as possible. You know, if you're discussing it down in the comments, please be respectful. But yeah, that's sort of the extent of everything I know. So let's move on, finally. Okay, so the final one we're going to look at today is Prussia. This is a bit of an older one. It's been over 150 years since the dissolution of Prussia, as I understand it anyway. As it exists here. I don't think the official dissolution was until a little bit later, but yeah. Okay, so Prussia, or Preußen, this little B here, means two S's in German. So, Prussia or Preußen, Old Prussian, or Prussia or Prussia, was a German state located on most of the northern European plain. Also occupying southern and eastern regions, it formed the German Empire when it united the German states in 1871. So we also talked about that a little bit in the Drawing a Map of Germany video that I did recently, so go and check that out. We talked a little bit about Prussia, but yeah. It was de facto dissolved by an emergency decree transferring powers of the Prussian government to German Chancellor Franz von Papen in 1932, and de jure, I'm guessing that just means officially, let's have a look, scratch practices that are legally recognised, yeah, I'm guessing that's like Latin or something, by an Allied decree in 1947. For centuries, the House of Hohenzollern ruled Prussia, expanding its size with the Prussian army. Prussia, with its capital Königsberg, and then when it became the Kingdom of Prussia in 1701, Berlin, decisively shaped the history of Germany. The name Prussia derives from the Old Prussians in the 13th century, the Teutonic Knights, an organized Catholic medieval military order of German crusaders, conquered the lands inhabited by them. In 1308, the Teutonic Knights conquered the region of Pomerelia with Danzig, modern-day Gdansk. That's in Poland, I think. Is it? Yes, northern Poland. Gdansk is the capital and largest city of the Pomeranian Voivodeship? I can't tell. Monday to Gdansk. Their monastic state was mostly Germanized through immigration from central and western Germany, and in the south it was Polonized by settlers from Masovia. The imposed Second Peace of Thorn in 1466 split Prussia into Western Royal Prussia, becoming a province of Poland, and the eastern part from 1525 called the Duchy of Prussia. A feudal fief, is that how you say that, fief, of the Crown of Poland up to 1657. The union of Brandenburg and the Duchy of Prussia in 1618 led to the proclamation of the Kingdom of Prussia in 1701. So Brandenburg is now a state in modern-day Germany that surrounds Berlin, and that's why you have the Brandenburg remember, Prussia is the historiographic denomination for the early modern realm of the Brandenburgian Hohenzollerns, from between 1608 and 1701, based in the Electorate of Brandenburg. The main branch of the Hohenzollern intermarried with the branch ruling the Duchy of Prussia. Interesting. Prussia entered the ranks of the great powers, so that's just like, sovereign states recognized having the ability and expertise to exert its influence on a global scale. Shortly after becoming a kingdom, it became increasingly large and powerful in the 18th and 19th centuries. It had a major voice in European affairs under the reign of Frederick the Great from 1740 to 1786, and at the Congress of Vienna in, at the Congress of Vienna, 1814 to 15. This was in the aftermath of the Napoleonic Wars, which redrew the map of Europe following Napoleon's defeat. Prussia acquired rich new territories, including the coal-rich Ruhr. The country then grew rapidly in influence economically and politically, and became the core of the North German Confederation in 1867, and then of the German Empire in 1871. The Kingdom of Prussia was now so large and so dominant in the new Germany that Junkers and other Prussian identified more and more as Germans and less as Prussians. I'm gonna, let's try and find more about, yes, here we go, Napoleonic Wars. During the reign of King Frederick William II, Prussia annexed additional Polish territory through the Second Partition of Poland in 1793 and the Third Partition of Poland in 1795. His successor, Frederick William III, announced the union of the Prussian Lutheran and Reformed Church. I'm guessing Martin Luther. And Reformed churches into one church. Prussia took a leading part in the French Revolutionary Wars, but remained quiet for more than a decade because of the Peace of Basel in 1795. Only to go once more to war with France in 1806 as negotiations with that country over the allocation of the spheres of influence in Germany failed. Prussia suffered a devastating defeat against Napoleon's troops at the Battle of Jena-Auerstedt, leading Frederick William III and his family to flee temporarily to Memel under the treaties of Tilsit. 1807, the state lost about one third of its area, including the areas gained from the second and third partitions of Poland, which now fell to the Duchy of Warsaw. Beyond that, the king was obliged to pay a large indemnity to cap his army at 42,000 men, so that's similar to what the Treaty of Versailles did to Germany, and to let the French garrison troops throughout Prussia, effectively making the kingdom a French satellite. In response to this defeat, reformers such as Stein and Hardenberg set about modernizing the Prussian state. Among their reforms were the liberation of peasants from serfdom, which was effectively slavery, but not quite, the emancipation of Jews and making full citizens of them. The school system was rearranged, and in 1818, free trade was introduced. The process of army reform ended in 1813 with the introduction of compulsory military service for men. By 1813, Prussia could mobilize almost 300,000 soldiers, so a lot more than the 42,000 that they should have had, more than half of which were conscripts of the Landwehr of variable quality. The rest consisted of regular soldiers that were deemed excellent by most observers, and very determined to repair the humiliation of 1806. After the defeat of Napoleon in Russia, Prussia quit its alliance with France and took part in the Sixth Coalition during the Wars of Liberation against French occupation. Prussian troops under Marshal Gebhard Leberecht von Blücher, wow, that's a name, contributed crucially alongside the British and the Dutch to the final victory over Napoleon at the Battle of Waterloo in 1815. Prussia his reward in 1815 at the Congress of Vienna was the recovery of her lost territories, as well as the whole of the Rhineland, Westphalia, 40% of Saxony, and some other territories. These western lands were of vital importance because they included the Ruhr region, the centre of Germany's fledgling industrialisation, especially in the arms industry. These territorial gains also meant the doubling of Prussia's population. In exchange, Prussia withdrew from areas of central Poland to allow the creation of Congress Poland under Russian sovereignty. In 1815, Prussia became part of the German Confederation. So, there's been many instances of Prussia, and they've took different forms. From what I understand, it's like bits of Poland, eastern parts mainly of Germany, Kaliningrad, where Kaliningrad is today. Oh, it says it here actually. Cialdowo. I'm guessing that's in Poland. Yeah. Klaipeda region, or Memel territory. Northernmost part of the German province of East Prussia. Himmelland is part of the administration. Okay. Warmia, Masuria. Both historical and ethnographic region. Northern Poland. Yeah, Northern Poland. Northeastern Poland. Recovered territories. Now Warsaw, Kaliningrad today is an enclave. Or is it an exclave? Russia, in between, is it, I can never get them the right way around, is it Lithuania and Poland? I could be wrong. Poland to the south, Lithuania to the north and east, yeah, there we go. And then Berlin and Brandenburg, as I was saying, that's like east, northeast Germany. We've talked about that a few times on the channel before. So yeah, it's quite confusing to know exactly what it was. Because it's had so many different, Northern March, Lutetian, Federation, Old Prussians, Margraviate of Brandenburg, Teutonic Order, Elector of Brandenburg, Duchy of Prussia, Marburg, Voivodeship, Prince Bishopric of Formia, Royal Polish Prussia, Brandenburg Prussia, Kingdom of Prussia, Free State of Prussia. So yeah, difficult to know exactly where and what it was at any given point, but yeah, I know most of it from the Napoleonic Wars, which we've talked about a few times, but yeah. So, I want to thank you very much for watching. If you made it this far, please drop a comment and let me know, if you've enjoyed. I hope you have. I might do another video, because there's a couple more I would like to talk about. I think there's at least three more, and we did three today, so I could get another video. This topic. So please let me know down below if you'd like to see another one, and I will get straight on it. But yeah, as I say, thank you ever so much for watching. Like and subscribe if you've enjoyed, and I will hopefully see you in the next video. Goodbye guys, and good night.